I feel like I reflect the scenery that's around me. And so when I'm in the beautiful trees and by rivers and streams, I feel beautiful.
Welcome to Shoulders Down, a podcast about intuitive eating and living. I'm your host, Leah Kern, and I'm an anti-diet dietitian and certified intuitive eating counselor. In this podcast, you will learn to harness your body's innate wisdom to govern not just how you eat, but also how you live. It is my mission to help you heal your relationship with food and body so you can live your most aligned and fulfilling life. Welcome, and I'm so glad that you're here. And welcome back to Shoulders Down. It has been a little while. I just took the last month off and I was on a hiking trip in New Hampshire with two of my very close friends. I've been trying to take a month off from my business since I started the business, and so far that's been going well. So this is a really special time for me. I will share more like through Instagram and my newsletter. So definitely check the show notes for those links to follow me there. But overall, what I'll share here is just that, like, being a person who puts out content for most of the year, it feels so important to me to take an extended amount of time where I'm not in that, like, content creation kind of like producing mode. And I just allow myself to be, instead of like living my life through the lens of like, how can I turn this into content all the time? So that has come to be a really, really important and valuable part of my work and keeping myself grounded in this work. So it was beautiful and amazing. And I'm so excited that I'll get to share a little bit more about like what the hike was, throughout this episode. So this episode is so special because the two of my very best friends in the world who I went on this hike with are on the podcast today, which is such a dream come true for me. This is my first episode, first of all, like interviewing two people and friends. It is so special. I cannot wait for you to listen and get to kind of like peek into what the last month of my life just looked like. And so a little background information. So we did a section hike of the Appalachian Trail. So for those of you who don't know, the Appalachian Trail is a through hiking trail that goes from Georgia all the way to Maine. And so people who through hike, meaning like hike the entire thing, typically take like 4 to 6 months to do it. And people often will start in like late February, early March, finish in like September-ish, end of August, September-ish. So what was really cool about the trip that we just went on is we did a section of the Appalachian Trail. So we hiked the New Hampshire section. New Hampshire is just one of many states that the trail goes through. And we did about 140-ish miles through the state of New Hampshire, which was beautiful and incredible. And it was a difficult section, but very rewarding, lots of views. And we got to meet a ton of people who were through hiking. So people who started in Georgia and made it all the way up to New Hampshire, which was so cool because they are like totally on a different wavelength, just like living in the woods for a long period of time. And it's always fun to talk to other hikers, especially through hikers, and just kind of like hear about their journey so far. So that's what we are doing. The other piece of background information that I'll give is the two friends I have on the podcast today, their names are Bea and Victoria, and I met them through on a backpacking trip, actually. So before freshman year of college, there was this like backpacking orientation trip option for freshmen, and I did that, and so did they, and that's how we met. And so just kind of like an extra detail of like why this trip was so special, because the three of us hadn't been on a trip like that since we met on a trip like that, which is just felt very full circle and special and meaningful and all the things. So what's really cool about this interview is obviously on this podcast, I talk a lot to a lot of people who have struggled with their relationship with food and body, whether those people have gone on to become dietitians or their former clients who share their story. And what's really unique about the interview that you're about to hear is Bea and Victoria had a very different experience growing up with food. And This is something that I noticed early on when I met them freshman year. So freshman year of college, when I met them, I was still deeply struggling with my own relationship with food and body. And I looked to the two of them of just like, oh my God, like they are just seemingly so carefree about food and not like uptight about exercise. They were like North Stars for me of like, oh my gosh, it's possible to have a more peaceful relationship with food and body. Like that's possible. They were the first two people in my life who really embodied just like naturally being intuitive eaters. And so just another reason why our relationship is so special to me. We get into much more of like the details of the trip in the interview that you're about to hear, but I just wanted to give that background info as to like how we are connected and what the backpacking trip that we just went on kind of the basic structure, what it looks like, and what thru hiking even is in the first place. So I really hope you enjoyed this episode, and I'm excited to be back here connected with you with regular episodes coming out every Tuesday. Make sure to check the show notes for the link to subscribe to my newsletter. After taking extended time away from Instagram, I'm feeling some resistance to going back to posting consistently. So I'll still be there. I'll still share things when I feel called to, of course, but I will definitely be prioritizing sending information and content out via my newsletter versus on Instagram. It's just what's feeling more right for me right now. So between the podcast and the newsletter, those are the two places that you can stay connected with me and learn about offerings and opportunities and get all the helpful intuitive eating tips. So without further ado, here is the interview with Bea and Victoria.
I am so excited to be here with two of my best pals. And it's like so feeling so funny to like be in this formal setting with them when I'm about to like grill them. But I have really been looking forward to this. So we're just going to dive right in with some questions reflecting on the last like 2 to 3 weeks ish we had in the woods hiking through New Hampshire. So I'd love if we can just start by giving the people some background on both of your relationships with food and body. So Victoria, if you want to go first, what is your story with your relationship with food and body, as much as you're comfortable getting into?
Sure. I've been thinking about how to describe my relationship with food kind of throughout our trip. And it starts with my family. I grew up with three brothers, and my house was always like the place where people came after school. My mom always had just like snacks and snacks and snacks. So I was always around just like all the fun kid food. And as I got older, I was like, wait, I don't want that stuff anymore. And so I was like, I'm doing my own thing, like really just to separate myself from my brothers. I was like, I'm a vegetarian. Like, I don't want to eat the stuff you guys are eating, thinking I was like older and mature to make that decision. So that was kind of like my first kind of opportunity to do my own thing. And I got into food that way. Just different recipes, vegetarian cooking. I was a vegetarian for 6 years and then stopped in college, mainly because I was done being difficult and picky and putting myself in a box. And I was like, wait, I like eating meat. I don't know why I'm doing this, and just left that behind. And now I really eat anything and everything. It's kind of cool. And I know we've talked about this, that exposure early on to like all the fun foods has allowed me to regulate and balance my cravings, if that makes sense.
Totally. Yeah. So, yeah. When I met you freshman year, like, I mean, I didn't even know what intuitive eating was then, but like looking back, you were just naturally an intuitive eater, and B too, which is like, was so interesting to me. Like, I'd never seen people who would just like get what they wanted and like seemingly have no guilt. Like, it was like completely unheard of to me. Mm-hmm. And so refreshing. So thank you for sharing that part of your story. And I know the three of us were all reflecting on our own periods of like vegetarianism and like where it came from. And I think it's interesting to hear the piece about like wanting to be different than your brothers and like kind of just have a way to like go off on your own.
Yeah,
I think that makes a lot of sense. And I also like hearing about how it stopped of like, I don't want to be difficult. And of course there's like instances where if it's like central enough to your values, like, sure, like it might be worth like the inconveniences, but it sounds like for you, it was like teetering on the line of like being more of a nuisance than like adding value to your life.
Definitely. Yeah. I definitely reached that point.
Yeah. So thank you for sharing those, the kind of the background on your relationship with food. We're going to circle back to body image, but her name is Beatrix, and we also have Beatrix Trixie. So it's the same person. We're only sitting here with two people, but
I respond to all of them.
Yeah, she responds to everything. Trix, if you can kind of give your background and your relationship with food as much as you're comfortable getting into for the people.
Yeah, I definitely feel lucky to say that I don't have anything huge to say on this. I also grew up in the snack household. People always came over to my house for the snacks. We had candy, we had chips, we had a lot of the good stuff. And so whenever people came over, the snack drawer was the first place we went. And I can remember really enjoying having all of those things with no hesitation. And I was always hungry when I got home too. So I was always diving straight into the snack drawer and was very grateful that it was there. Similarly, Victoria, I watched an environmental documentary once and stopped eating red meat for a while. And there was a lot of environmental inspiration behind that choice, but there was also a lot of guilt involved, especially growing up in California. We are always in a drought. And so one of the main things that was pushed home in that documentary was a hamburger is equivalent to 1 week's worth of showers, or maybe even more than that. And so I was like, oh geez, okay, I'm not going to eat red meat. I think I did that for like 2 or 3 years. And it was definitely an inconvenience to my family. And there was a lot of jokes and guilt involved with the environment. And then I reached a point where, yeah, similarly, I wasn't liking being difficult. And also, I really wanted a burger and was also kind of noticing that changes in the environmental world needed to be more systemic and less individual. Not that the individual can't make a change, but that was kind of the one major thing that led me to eat burgers again. And I'm glad I do.
Yeah. One thing, like just hearing you both kind of go through your stories, like notably, you know, I've had a bunch of people on the podcast now, and you guys are so different in that, like Bea just said, like, she's grateful to say, like, the story isn't that long, like, there's not much to say, which is really unique. And I think will be interesting for listeners to hear, because as I thought when I met you both freshman year, like, it is so rare to have, like, escaped mostly unscathed by diet culture, especially as, like, a young woman. And it's interesting to hear, obviously I know both of your families, that you were like the snack households, both of you kind of have that in common, because when I talk to a lot of my clients, like one thing that they'll often say is like, we had the healthy stuff. Like we were like the healthy household, and they would like go to friends and family's house and find themselves like binging on like, you know, the forbidden things, which is just such a textbook example of like, if you have it around, you habituate to it. If you don't, it's on a pedestal and it's special and you feel out of control around it. So it's cool to hear both of your stories kind of like really show that phenomenon. And then the other thing I just want to like reflect back that I think is interesting is, especially Bea, with your story, even though the piece about restricting doesn't come necessarily from a place of like to manipulate the size or shape of your body, the element that's the same is guilt. Mm-hmm. And guilt doesn't serve you. Like, it, and like you said, when it got to a place of like, oh no, like I'm like wasting California's water, like that ultimately causes downstream effects in your body that isn't serving you, and you're part of the planet. So like you deserve to, you know, feel good too. So I just think that's a really valuable piece for people to reflect on. Like, when is there guilt involved? There's something deeper to look at there.
Right. There's different factors going into restricting that don't come from dieting.
Exactly.
Other external forces.
Exactly. And they can cause the same kind of like end effect, which is like overthinking, guilt, obsession. Mm-hmm. And those are the things that ultimately like can get in the way of like your life and your happiness. Mm-hmm. So I think it's important to show that like, it's not always about dieting. Other things can interfere with, you know, our ability to naturally just eat intuitively. Yeah. And I also love how simple the moment be of like, I just wanted a burger again. Like that's a great indicator. Your body's asking for it. Okay. Well, maybe like it needs it on, you know, some level that beyond what you can like even really understand.
I was sick of going to In-N-Out and getting the grilled cheese. It's literally just a cheeseburger without the meat patty. So unsatisfying. It was so sad.
So depressing. Yeah.
You can only eat so many like veggie wraps. I was like, I want a turkey wrap.
Yeah. Veggie wraps just don't hit the same. And like, if you're listening to this and you're a vegetarian or a vegan and you don't have those cravings, like, awesome. That's great, you know, but I think it is important to note when like you are starting to have those cravings, like I'm really looking at the situation, ask yourself, like, why am I denying myself this? Is this worth it for me? Mm-hmm. So I'd love if we can kind of circle back to the body image piece. The question that I like to use to kind of get at the body image story is, and Victoria, we'll start with you again. What is your earliest memory of thinking that you needed to manipulate the size or shape of your body?
Sure. Yeah, this question came up earlier and I haven't really reflected on it in a very long time. But when you kind of pose it to us, like this memory flashed back to being in middle school and being in band class. And I was sitting, it was like warm out and everyone was wearing shorts. And we were sitting, you know, in the seats next to each other. And I remember like looking to the girls like to my side and being like, whoa, like, their legs don't go out as much as mine. And that was my first memory of being like, my body's a little different than some other girls with like thinner legs. Mine are more muscular. I don't think I wanted to change that, but it was my memory of realizing body types, different body types.
Yeah. Yeah. That's a really vivid first memory to kind of flash into your mind. Like, even if it's not like, this is bad, I want to change it. Just like the noticing of like, oh, I look different than another person. Yeah.
Sure. And some of that, I felt an insecurity. I didn't know to know that I could change it, but it was definitely an insecurity for a while of just having like stronger legs than other girls. And feeling like I didn't fit in to a certain stereotype, especially where I grew up.
Yeah. It's also interesting to hear that like there wasn't necessarily like the thought wasn't followed by like, how do I change this to look like those girls?
Yeah.
Because that's almost like mature in a way that I think most people at that age like are almost naive to think, oh, I could change this. And rightfully so, because of all the messaging we're getting of like, if you work hard enough, if you eat like clean enough, like you could look like those other girls. Yeah. But the reality is like, so much of it is just your genetic blueprint and how like you're built. So for you to be like, oh, this is different, and I'm like, it's not necessarily something I can change. It's kind of like beyond your time. Yeah.
I don't think I knew. I was like in sixth, seventh grade. And I was just like, oh, well, shit.
Yeah.
I guess life goes on. I don't know. But coming full circle until now, just learning to embrace your body, like it's definitely a journey, and we're still on it every day.
So. Yeah. Yeah. Thank you for sharing the early memory. Trix, can you think of the first time you remember either like noticing your body was different or thinking that you wanted to manipulate the size or shape of it?
Yes, I can actually think of a couple times all in the same time period, which is like that early middle school era. Mm-hmm. And I think the manipulation had less to do with food and more to do with exercise. So I was really surrounded by people who are exercising all the time. I have to go run on a run. I have to go do this. I have to go do that. And I think that pressure and seeing that as normal was kind of my way to manipulate my body. And so there are a couple things. First, hearing women who I looked up to saying, oh, I could lose a few pounds here, or I could lose a few there. And then looking at my body being like, we're the same size. We look the same. Do I need to do that too? Mm-hmm. And I remember going on a couple runs being like, okay, I'm in middle school. I'm going to like change the way my body looks, when really my body was changing in so many different ways to become who I am now. So I don't even know if I had much control at that point. And another thing, in middle school, I was really heavily playing soccer. And it was the era of the skinny jeans. And I remember going to the store and trying on jeans, and nothing fit over my thighs, nothing. And even if they did, it didn't fit right. And it was such a hard experience, because a product of something that I loved so much doing, playing soccer, was now making me feel super self-conscious when I was trying on these clothes. But I do remember going to soccer practice recently after, and some other girls on our team were talking about that too. They were like, oh, the soccer thighs, like we had the soccer thighs. And in some ways that was kind of validating of like, okay, other people are going through this as well. But it was hard at some points. Skinny jeans. I'm glad that we're
Totally. And so upon noticing, oh, my thighs are bigger than other people's or they don't fit into the skinny jeans, do you have memories of being like, besides like the thinking, like maybe in the back of your head, like on a run, like, oh, maybe this will change it. Mm-hmm. Do you have memories of like intentionally trying to manipulate that? Or was it similar to Victoria and just like a noticing without necessarily like, okay, and now I'm going to like try and like manipulate this?
I think manipulating through exercise a little bit, and also just trying to fit in with people's styles and clothes, mm-hmm. even though it was so uncomfortable.
Yeah.
So maybe not as much manipulating my body, but manipulating my image a little bit.
Yeah. Interesting. Yeah. Like conforming to what the people are wearing.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Again, just like interesting to reflect on, because again, when I go through this question often with clients, it's like, this is a time I noticed my body was different. And here's like 10, 20, 30, 40, mm-hmm. 50 years to follow of every single thing I did to try mm-hmm. to manipulate the size or shape of my body to, you know, look like the way I felt like it's supposed to. Mm-hmm. So just another beautiful example, of course, like everyone has their own struggles, and it doesn't mean you guys like had no struggles in life or anything, but just another really beautiful example of like, the story doesn't always look the same, like, thank God. And I'm curious, this wasn't a question I like asked you guys before to reflect on, but it's something that's coming to my mind right now. What do you think, besides like the abundance factor, abundance of like snack foods in the house, what do you think allowed you to like mostly escape unscathed by diet culture? What were the factors you think that like helped you get to that place?
I was thinking about this as we were talking about body image stuff, and I feel lucky for my parents, honestly. Like, my mom never talked about diet stuff. She was just like, yeah, like whatever, just you're fine, you're a kid, you're growing. And I never felt like an external pressure from my mom, especially then to just be happy in your own skin. So I feel really grateful and lucky to have escaped diet culture by looking at my mom as just a role model, because we have similar body types. And mm-hmm. I was like, she's crushing it. I can too, I guess.
Yeah. That's awesome. That's so awesome. And yeah, as we know, like the mother-daughter relationship can really either like positively or negatively impact these things. And I love that your mom just kind of, it sounds like, kind of just like left you to your own devices with like, yeah, she'll figure it out. She's growing. And like, that's actually the best thing you can do. Cause like, like you said, you naturally stopped craving like the snack foods, the more like play foods, and like wanted different foods, because your body was like naturally like, ooh, maybe like other things would sound good. So it just shows that when there are no rules, you naturally gravitate towards what you need anyway.
Right. Yeah. She had like loose structure of like healthy, not like kind of stuff, but nothing extreme.
Yeah. That's awesome. Dee, what about you?
I also feel so grateful for my parents. I grew up watching them eat anything and everything. We always had ice cream. We always had plenty of food. I really can't think of anything that was withheld from us, which I think was very important to show me that I could eat anything, and I had it available for me too. I think that was really major. I think I grew up in a smaller body, and so I think I was also less, that wasn't pointed out, or it wasn't right in my face all the time. So I did have a different experience in that regard as well. And also grateful that my parents never talked about people's bodies or talked about our bodies, really. Mm-hmm. That was never a topic of conversation. So yeah, I'm really grateful for my family.
Yeah. Something I'm thinking about as you're sharing that is like, I've spent a lot of time in both of your homes, with both of your families, and like food has always felt so fun. Like I'm thinking specifically about like your mom being like, look at these scones I brought home from this place. That's so fun. It's not just like food is allowed, but like food is like fun and like celebrated. And those are beautiful things to support a healthy relationship with food. And also thank you for bringing up the piece about body.
Yeah.
Because even if you grow up in a family where your parents are super supportive, if you happen to exist in a larger body, like you might go to a doctor and they, you know, according to, you know, BMI, which we know is bullshit, they might like prescribe a diet. And then there you go. You just got derailed. Even if you grew up in a supportive family that was abundant with like all kinds of foods and those kind of things. So that's a really important point.
Definitely.
Okay, so now to talk about the hike. So by the time we get here in the episode, I would have given an intro on the hike so people know what just went down. I want to ask you guys about how your relationship and connection with your body felt different on the hike versus like in regular day-to-day life.
I can hop in.
Go for it.
Before the hike, I was sitting down a lot. Always at a desk, always hunched over a computer. And so that change, I really felt that. Specifically, I was telling you both about this. I had like a pinched nerve in my back and I was feeling like an old lady. Like I couldn't lay down on a flat surface without my back hurting. And I really do attribute that to sitting down a lot for the majority of the day. And so when I started walking, that went away. And it was like an amazing moment for me of just being really proud of my body and feeling very strong. So just feeling grateful for moving the way that I do and being able to hike up these mountains. I wasn't really thinking about how I looked either because we were wearing the same clothes every day. So it was not important. We weren't looking at ourselves all the time. More just feeling grateful for my toes and my feet and my legs, and also noticing those differences of doing that repetitive hiking every day and feeling myself getting stronger was a really cool feeling. Yeah. I'm really grateful for my body.
Yeah. So it sounds like your connection to like kind of like summarize, like your connection to your body just like got stronger through this experience, which makes sense because you're using it so much. It like is your vehicle and your tool throughout, you know, the last few weeks, and the noticing like, oh, the pinched nerve went away. Like those little things that maybe like we just don't even notice in our body day to day because you're just like distracted and busy.
Exactly.
Very similar to Trix. I feel like when you are relying on your body just day in and day out to that extent, you notice every little thing that's happening. And that was a really cool experience. Very different from day-to-day life, where you're just like, your toe hurts a little, like oh, whatever, but it's like heightened when you're hiking. And so that heightened feeling of being in tune with every aspect of your body is a really cool experience. And yeah, I've done extended backpacking trips, but nothing to this length. And so to really dive into that and rely on your body that much and be that in tune was really special. When something hurts, it really hurts.
Right.
When it gets better, you're really happy. And the overall feeling like grateful for my body too, like B said, I really felt, I was like, wow, I didn't really prepare or train for this hike. And to kind of get up off the couch and go, I just felt really lucky.
Yeah.
Honestly, to sum it up.
Yeah. A metaphor that's coming to mind here, and you describe this is like, it's almost like your car, like if your car is like making a weird noise or like something's like rattling or something, like you might like regularly ignore it. But if you're about to like take it on a big trip or something, it's like, oh my God, we need to get to the shop. Like what's going on? Like we might not get there. And I just think about like the body, like on a hike like this, like it is your car. Like if your like toe hurts or like when your muscles really hurt, it's like, oh my God, are we going to be able to make it to the destination today? Like you're like, it's like crucial.
Hope it holds up.
Hope it holds up. Yeah.
Something we heard on the trail too that I really liked is people were saying that people who listen to their bodies and really pay attention to if they need a break or not, or if they need to take some time to heal something, those are the people who end up finishing the trail most likely. Yeah. And that was huge because I think that a lot of the times people just want to push through it or like, I'll be fine, whatever. But really, if you're not fine out there, you need a break.
You're not fine.
Finish it. Just like if your car is broken down, you won't be able to drive.
Right.
So I really liked that of just listening to your body and taking a break and taking a rest is the most important thing to be able to finish it.
Yeah. I love that you brought that up. Do you guys remember someone told us that
Shrek?
Yeah. I'll name Shrek on the trail. That like, that there's some statistic about like woman being more likely to make it to finish the Appalachian Trail. And I think we were kind of like picking apart, like, why is that? And we don't know, obviously this is all like speculation, but like what it seems like is men have like more ego and are like less willing to stop or take a break. Whereas women are like more likely to listen to their body and be like, okay, I need to like take a 0 day today and rest and get back out there tomorrow. And that's just like cool. Cause intuitive eating or intuitive living, being intuitive with your body, can like literally make or break your ability to like finish such a big feat like this.
Definitely. Right. And also practicing speaking up. My personality is more of just like swallow it, like you're fine, suppress it, but that doesn't fly when you're hiking long distance. You really have to, especially with people or in a group, you have to voice what hurts so it doesn't get worse over time. Like in the beginning, my feet were killing me in these hiking boots and I was just like, oh, I can get through it, like it's fine. And Leah, you were like, no, get your shoes overnighted to you, like fix this. And that like initiative to speak up and address the problem was something that was really helpful, obviously.
Yeah. I'm glad you brought that up because it is like your body speaking to you, and you can say like, shh, we'll just tough it out. Right. But like, you also can listen to it and say, what do you need? Oh, you want me to like try to figure out a way to get new shoes? Like, okay, like I could do that.
Yeah.
And I think that that skill like overflows into so many parts of life.
It really does. It's one thing to notice it, but it's another thing to act on it. That acting piece is so important.
Yeah.
I'm proud of you, Victoria. I saw a lot of growth in that on this trip.
Give me the hard.
Yeah. And that's so necessary because it's like you said, in the group dynamic, it affects everyone. Like, like if you want to be by yourself and be like, oh yeah, I'll just muscle through, like, sure. But like when there's other people involved, it could like actually make a big impact for like the group as a whole. Yeah, that's a really good example. Okay, I want to know about what differences you guys noticed with your cravings and your appetite on the trail versus off the trail.
I noticed getting so hungry so fast. Like 1 minute I'd be fine. And then 5 minutes later, I'd be like, I need food now or else I'll start my pull-ups. And just how fast that changed and how, like we were just talking about, you need to honor your body or else your car's not going to have any fuel. You have to stop and eat. I also noticed craving a lot of salty, like meaty, dense cheese and meat. Was craving that a lot and was craving it early in the morning. By 10 a.m. we were eating bacon and cheese and that's what I wanted. Because my body was like, you need to feed me. So I definitely noticed just the amount that I was craving and also the difference in what I was craving, because before I got on the trail, it was really hot. It was starting to get really hot. And so I was really craving just like light things and vegetables, really fresh things. But when we got on the trail, it was totally different.
Yeah, it sounds like you were craving much more energy dense things, which makes sense because you're expending so much energy. And I also really think the piece about noticing that you're getting hungrier so much faster is really interesting, because when you said that, I'm like, oh yeah, same. Like, whereas in regular life, I can like trace it coming on kind of gradually. But when hiking, it was just like, oh my God, like it just like a switch flips and it's like, I need food now.
You swallow the packs, everybody. Shit's everywhere. I totally felt that too, of like the really fast hunger that just like hits your body and you have to act on it. I liked how we had just the variety, like the ability to choose, like we had a bunch of different snack options and that was really helpful. I don't think I was craving like one specific thing every day, but it was really nice to have the options of like, oh, I want something like a gummy or a bar or a cracker, whatever just sounds good in the moment, and having that available on the trail was really nice. So our variety really came in clutch.
And even though it was a variety, like it wasn't such a big variety, like it's only what we could take. And I have to say, like from the last long distance hiking trip, that was something where I was like, oh, there wasn't enough variety. Mm-hmm. And I really noticed that, mm-hmm. like, oh, I would be like looking at another hiker's like Nutella and be like, God damn it, I fucking need that Nutella. I don't need it. Jump your throat or steal it while you sleep. And I was like, okay, like I want like some chocolatey things. And then like, mm-hmm. We also didn't have enough on the last hike, like cheesy, savory, crunchy things. So it's like, okay, like there's these kind of buckets, like chocolatey, cheesy, crunchy, like you said, the gummy, like mm-hmm. different things. And then like fatty, like bacon mm-hmm. and like sausage, cheese. And though you can't have nearly as much variety as you would if you just open your fridge, you're like, what am I craving today? Mm-hmm. You can still find these small ways to give yourself some choice. And mm-hmm. I feel like we did a great job with that this trip, because I definitely never felt like super deprived.
Yeah, I would agree.
Yeah. How about you, Lee? How did your cravings change?
The things you guys are saying resonate with me more. Hunger coming on more intensely. Definitely, I work from home and I sit at a desk most of the time. I'll like go for a walk around the block or something, but I like in general lately, my amount of movement like hasn't been that high. And I noticed it. I had such a bigger appetite, which probably likely 100% has to do with being more active and expending more energy, which honestly felt good. Because some often while at home, I'd like wish my appetite was bigger. But yeah, like a mix of factors, it being summer, like being busy during the day, and also just like not being super active in the last few months, like my appetite just wasn't so big. So it was kind of fun to like get to experience like the way food tastes when your body's just like really, really needs it. Like it's using that bacon or whatever we're eating like immediately, like to just fuel you through the hike. So I did notice like the experience of eating felt like more rewarding because I could feel like my body just like eating it up and like being like, thank you. Like we're using this.
It was very enjoyable. Every time we ate, it was like, yes, this tastes so good.
It's a celebration. Wherever we were on the trail, it was just like, I was comparing it to like three bears just like eating honey out of like a beehive. Yeah. I felt like three bears like sitting around our snack bags like
And I was going to probably get into this more like in the intro, but I think it's cool to share with both of you. So the backpacking trip that we met on, which at this point was like 7-8 years ago almost, which is crazy. I was still in the thick of my own food issues. And I remember thinking on that trip, like, oh my God, this is horrible. Like we don't have salad. We don't have anything like fresh. Like, oh my God, this is so bad. I'm going to come out of this trip so unhealthy. Meanwhile, like I was meeting new people. We're outside all day. We're like hiking so much. And I felt guilty every time we ate anything. And I was so just in my head. And it's just cool so many years later to do a very similar trip with both of you. And like literally was not even a thing that crossed my mind. It was just like, this food is amazing. It's fueling us like great. Like it just so feels so deep in the past now that like it's just like not, wasn't a thing. There's so many other things to worry about on a hike. Like what's the weather? Like how many more miles do we get to camp? Like, you know, how's everyone's body doing? Like that, like having to worry about food too. Like I don't think it would have been like possible. Like, I don't think my bandwidth for like emotional energy could have sustained like worrying about something as central as food.
That makes perfect sense.
That's amazing.
Yeah, it's cool.
I'll take it one further. Even if, like you said, it didn't cross your mind, but even past that, you were excited about what we had to eat and excited about the combinations of food that you created. And that is amazing too. And very, very freeing.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. There's so much more. There's so much more. Does anyone have anything they want to add in terms of your appetite on the trail versus off the trail?
I think I was just like less picky, honestly. Mm-hmm. I was like down for whatever.
Yeah.
I don't know. Everything just sounded good. Nothing sounded gross. It was just all like, sure.
Yeah.
That's so true.
Yeah. And so a question to follow up with that is, what are some things that you maybe wouldn't have imagined yourself eating off the trail that you found yourself eating on the trail?
Yes, immediately what comes to mind is like one of our last days, we like took a quick break and it was like 10:30 and I whiffed out like this packet of like buffalo chicken and just ate it out of the little pouch. And I was like, this is weird. I would never eat this like in normal life, but I'm hungry. It's in my snack bag and I want to eat it. So yeah. I ate it and it was fine, but it was a weird thing to choose at that time for sure.
Yeah. And what do you think allowed you to be able to just be like, yeah, I'm just eating this now, even though like in like regular life, I would never do this.
I think I was just really hungry and like the protein sounded good and I wanted something filling and savory and that fit the bill. And
yeah.
I didn't want to carry it anymore.
It's heavy.
It makes your pack heavy. Yeah.
Which was another thing, because we kept talking about like, I was just like, let's eat our stuff so our packs are lighter, which is an interesting like thing to think about, weight versus, I don't know how to say that, but
yeah, like put it in your body so it's not on your back. B, what about you? What's something you ate on the trail that you wouldn't have imagined yourself eating in regular life?
I love cheese, but I am mildly lactose intolerant, so it usually really upsets my stomach. And we had a big block of sweaty cheese in our bag, and I really wanted it still, even though it had been in our warm packs for a while. That felt way more satisfying than just crackers or like fake cheese, which isn't satisfying. And my stomach didn't really hurt that bad this trip. So amazing. I was eating a lot of cheese, which was really nice and satisfying, and way more. It's just more what I wanted than just dry crackers. And I guess I love sweets, but I don't eat a ton of candy. And I ate a lot of candy. Mm-hmm. That's like, all I wanted was the gummies, the Scandinavian swimmers. Yeah. I wanted those so bad, and peanut M&Ms. Oh, it just tasted so good.
And I love that. Like, the body is so smart. Like, of course we want candy. Like, it's the quickest thing that we'll have access to in our bloodstream. Like, it's like there. And so that's why when someone's like, candy's unhealthy, it's like, compared to what? Like, you know, like in what context? Like, guess what? Like, having like lettuce and kale on this trip would have been wildly unhealthy because we wouldn't have made it. Like,
no, we would not have made it.
Been on the trail, left in the woods somewhere. Tired.
Dribbled up and had no fuel. But like a Snickers is like just about the quote unquote, like, if health is about like what's going to support your body best. Well, like a Snickers and gummies and like candy, because it hits your bloodstream fast. You have access to the energy immediately, which you need because you're having a snack and then continuing to hike. So I just love putting things in context like that, of like, it all depends and it's all relative and there's a place for everything.
Yes.
Same with sugary drinks. Like, my God, a soda, a cold soda was so good.
Yeah.
Or a cold beer was so good. Yeah. Not only because it's cold, but just a variety of flavor too, and the sugar was, that's another thing.
That's a great point. We were like joking that it was like the summer of soda, like there's like such a thing called trail magic that like some people who are like in the through hiking community will park in a parking lot where the trail crosses and just like have a cooler full of like sodas or whatever. And it's the best thing you can come across. Cause like B said, like it's cold, it's sugary, and that your brain is just like, oh my God, yes, that, because it's such easy energy. And that's exactly what you need and what you want. So yeah. A thing, me and B were talking about yesterday in the car was like, there, I don't know how we got into this conversation, but for me, there's like certain food rolls that were sort of like the last to go that were like really, really, really sneaky. Mm-hmm. And one of them was like no sugar sweetened beverages. Like, even though I consider myself an intuitive eater and having had healed my relationship with food for years now, one that lingered was like, sugar sweetened beverages, like probably shouldn't have that, you know, like really, really sneaky in the background. And I would say only in like the last like 2 years, really, would I just like absolutely shamelessly crack a soda. And just trust that like, yep, there's sugar and my body knows how to handle it.
Yeah.
Yeah. That was a very sweet part of the trail.
Yeah.
Loved the soda.
A thing that the three of us talked about eating that we wouldn't have usually eaten was the sort of like gas station bacon, egg, and cheese and cheese. So there are like a few times where we had to get off the trail and resupply. And, you know, before going back on, we'd stop at like gas station, grab whatever. And the last time we did that, we got like some breakfast sandwiches from this like random gas station in New Hampshire. And, you know, I don't think any of us were like, oh, you know, this isn't like nice. This isn't like a good bacon egg and cheese. We're just like, oh my God, like it's a cooked sandwich. Like how lovely.
Yeah.
Good.
Yeah.
It tasted good.
Yeah. And like in normal life, like I can kind of admit almost that like I would have a level of almost like elitist like view on like, ugh, a gas station, you know, sandwich, like who would eat that? And I think it's such an important point of like, food is food at the end of the day, you know, like, and it still provides you fuel, and we don't need to like be eating like kale smoothies and quinoa. Like that's not like the best way to fuel your body. Like at the end of the day, what's most important is like having food. And for some people, like a gas station sandwich is like what they have access to. And the most important consideration in nutrition is having an adequate amount of fuel. So if that, you know, you're not going to have an adequate amount of fuel if you're eating like quinoa and kale, like we said, like those things aren't energy dense and also often like very expensive and just like not within reach for people. Yeah. Whereas, you know, prepackaged foods or like something you might get at a gas station is more realistic for a lot of the population, a lot of the demographic in our country. And so I thought that that was just like an interesting moment to reflect on my own, like, kind of bias about like, ugh, gas station food is gross. And it's like, no, actually it's just food.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Gas station pizza.
Mm-hmm. Amazing.
Fueled us for three meals.
Yes. So good.
Exactly. I think this is also a really beautiful example of you can't eat the same things across different experiences that you're having. Yes. Like if you're saying this diet is the diet I need to follow for all aspects of my life, whatever I'm doing, that really wouldn't have worked on this trip. We needed to eat the things that we were eating. We needed
totally.
To eat. I felt like I needed to eat anything I could get my hands on at certain points. And so, like you were saying, if we were drinking kale smoothies, we would not have made it through this trip. So I think just showing that it can be different what you're consuming, doing different activities based on what your body needs.
Yeah. And I also just want to say, like, even if you're not like going on a through hike or something like that, like might be kind of like an extreme example. Like if you're going on a road trip, maybe that's like something more relatable. Like, yeah, you might find yourself at a gas station where they don't have like bougie smoothie bowls and whatever. We keep using smoothies as an example, but there's that whole like wellness kind of like realm of food. And it's a great example of like you're saying, be like, if your diet or lifestyle or whatever it is, like says like nothing processed, well, you're going to be hungry at that gas station because everything is processed. Intuitive eating and like having no rules, of course, unless you have a medically indicated allergy or something, that's not what we're talking about, opens up so much flexibility to experience things that you might not otherwise be able to experience.
Right. Something that comes to mind when you're saying this that I thought of a lot is like, what is satisfying right now for me? Like when we went into a gas station or a restaurant or whatever, it was like, what sounds satisfying? And if for me, knowing what was satisfying fueled me, because it sounded good. And I wanted those things. I wanted that savory sandwich or that cheesy pizza. And I really enjoyed connecting with the satisfying sound of different foods as they presented themselves at our different stops.
Yeah. And it's like the question, what is satisfying? It's almost like the answer is louder when you're like, in need of fuel. So it's a fun time to pose that question.
Yeah.
Something that made me think of too, is whenever we would go into town, if I was too hungry, it would be really hard for me to pick what I wanted.
Right.
Like I couldn't even tell what would be satisfying for me. I was just thinking, I need everything in here. Which made it really hard, actually. If I got past the point of if I got to really, really hungry, extreme hunger, we were using your
total
hunger scale.
We did.
Which was helpful because there were some points where I was like, I don't really need to stop, but I am hungry. And if we waited, then I would get to a point where I was too hungry to even eat sometimes, which is in that situation, honestly, a dangerous situation to be in because you need food. If you're not hungry, you need to eat it anyway.
Totally. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And this brings up such a good point of like, intuitive eating exists at the intersection of instinct, emotion, and logic. So like instinct, is intuition, what you feel like, what you're craving. Emotion is like what sounds like, kind of like what would satisfy me emotionally, like ice cream on the couch, like kind of like what would like warm your heart.
Yes.
And logic is what you know is going on in your day and what you logically know. So the moment of being like, okay, my intuition says like, I'm not like super, super hungry, but like logically I know, like if I wait right now, this could get in a situation where I become very hungry. So like, mm-hmm. even though I'm not there yet, like, let me just like use my like rational brain here and choose to eat, kind of like override the cue. Whereas in like regular life, you might be like, nah, I'll just wait till I get to like a little hungrier. I think on the trail, it's like you said, it can become dangerous if you get too hungry. And I have one other example of like the logic being so important. In the beginning of the trip, when I was experiencing like so much anxiety, just like the start of the trip was really like hard for me. And when we would stop to eat, I physically wasn't feeling hungry because the anxiety was like disrupting my attunement with my body's cues. And so it was such a moment of having to be like, okay, logically, I know I just hiked like X amount of miles. I need to put something in, even though my cues are saying like, no, we're not hungry. I need to override that right now. And I know we spoke a little bit about this kind of like phenomenon. I'm curious if you guys ever had an experience where you had to use your logical brain to override your cues.
I think in the morning, right when we woke up, knowing that we were about to have a long day of hiking, I wasn't hungry, but if I didn't eat anything, my body wouldn't have been able to move and do all of that. So in the mornings, I think was pretty tricky, but having something that I really liked eating was helpful. And when I didn't, it was hard.
Mm-hmm. I would agree with the mornings. Just waking up that early in the woods, it's like, sometimes like for me, I was like nauseous. I was like, oh God, like packing up your shit and you like gotta shove food down. So it wasn't the most enjoyable time to eat, but knowing, your body needed it. And also just if I wasn't feeling hungry, but somebody else was and we stopped for a snack break, using that time to refuel myself, even though I didn't necessarily need the snack break, just optimizing whatever opportunity there was to get some more energy.
Totally.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Those are both good examples. What were you going to say, Church?
I was just agreeing with Victoria of optimizing those opportunities whenever we stopped eating something, at least something.
Yeah. Totally. Yeah. So you kind of started talking, Trix, about the experience in town, like not wanting to get too hungry because then it's like, oh my God, I am so overwhelmed by all these choices. I don't know what to pick. I'm curious. So just for background info, we went into town maybe like sort of three separate times to resupply, which means like going into a grocery store, like having access to a restaurant, like going out to like a meal, staying off the trail and then getting back on the next day. And I'm curious to hear about both of your experiences specifically, like either in a restaurant or like a grocery store situation, you know, like a deli or something where we were going to get like food off the trail. What was that like for you? Did you ever notice yourself eating past comfortable fullness, like because it was available? What was that experience like?
It was a little overwhelming because I knew all the options that we had on the trail and that was kind of all we had. So I was in the mindset of we have this, we're going to eat this. Mm-hmm. And then when we went in town, when there was an abundance of variety and options, it was overwhelming because I was hungry all the time and I wanted all of it. And so I did end up feeling too full a lot of the time because I think my body was in that survival mode of if we have the time to eat as much as you can, because if we get out on the trail, we won't have this option. And so I definitely was too full a lot of the times that we went into town. It was really satisfying in the moment. And I don't know if I would change it, but leaving the restaurants, I always felt very full. And I think it was that mindset of like, I don't have access to this, so I need to eat it all right this moment because it's going to be gone. Yeah. And that was overwhelming and also caused me to eat past comfortable fullness.
Yeah.
I would agree with the overwhelming aspect, like going into the gas stations and being like, okay, I want a cold drink. And there's like 50,000 options. Like, yeah. I don't know. That was overwhelming for me to just choose something like that. But for the restaurants, I think I was just excited to eat something different, like eat a hot meal, like ordering a cheeseburger, like never really do that, mm-hmm. and eating the whole thing. That was pretty cool. So just like different experiences, I guess. I had fun. I liked going into the restaurants. I think I am okay at honoring hunger cues. So that wasn't necessarily something I experienced, but just food made by other people, hot food was, mm-hmm. was fun.
Yeah. I would say I fall more into like the camp of like it was a little harder to stop when full because it's just like this isn't going to be available like literally mm-hmm. tomorrow or in some mm-hmm. cases like in an hour once we're in the woods again. And I think that again really just like captures the phenomenon that happens with dieting, like restriction mm-hmm. leads to feelings of being out of control around these foods, because when you do have them, when they are around, you're like, this is my last chance. I have to get it all in now. Whereas in our case, it's like the last supper mentality, the last chance had nothing to do with dieting. Wasn't that like, oh, it's restricted tomorrow. It's that like, well, it kind of was restricted tomorrow, mm-hmm. but not because of a rule, but because like of the logistics of a through hike. You can't like get a cheeseburger anytime you want. Like you're deep in the woods sometimes and it's going to be days. Yeah, I definitely noticed specifically that night we went to the restaurant where we all got burgers. I remember being like, okay, I like could stop, but like it feels a little hard because like, mm-hmm. oh my God, this cheeseburger is so special right now. Mm-hmm. And I think I left the restaurant feeling like a little bit like, woof, that's like the most food that's like been put into my stomach at one time in like a long time, and like no guilt or shame about that, but just like, oh, that feels a little bit physically uncomfortable. But like Bea said, I don't think I would change anything, because it's like the cool thing about intuitive eating is you can like intentionally choose to eat past comfortable fullness and be like, I know, like, I think I could have said going into that experience that was probably going to happen. Mm-hmm. And that's okay. Cause it's like, this is stuff that like I'm not gonna have and I want it and that's okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I want to add too, and I don't know if you're planning on bringing this up later, but the huts were kind of like a restaurant along the way. Mm-hmm. And to explain a little bit, basically the White Mountains has these full service huts that you can pay X amount of dollars to stay in and like get a dinner and a breakfast and a bunk, and we utilized them twice, which was really cool. We stayed in them twice, and also we passed through them all, and they had like deals for through hikers. And I noticed myself acting different in the huts, like vulture mentality that I never really do like elsewhere. Just like, where are your leftovers? Like whatever you have, because it was different and it was like homemade and it was good. And so that kind of like scavenger behavior around food was something I noticed myself doing, just like too excited about the hut food.
Give me your leftover bread and soup.
Literally. And that's a good distinction, because the huts like were out there, like when they were deep into the woods, and it was an opportunity deep into the woods to have something homemade or different, like what didn't come out of our like, you know, food bag. And that was special too. And I also just think about like the phenomenon of like habituation. Like we would have food for like 5 days, and it was like, you just by the end of the 5 days, it's like, okay, we know what we have. It's all kind of boring. And then you see something like in town or in one of the huts, and it's like, that's exciting just because it's different. And I think it really just speaks to like the, when someone's like, oh my God, I could never have this food around, like I would just eat it all. And it's like, well, actually, if you had it around all the time, you would probably get sick of it and it would lose its power. And it just really like, again, also there's so many things about this experience that I think like capture phenomenons like in the intuitive eating world. So I just like to pull those out, obviously. I want to pivot a little bit more back to body image. We kind of started talking about this earlier, but obviously, like there were very few instances of looking in a mirror on this trip. We were in the woods and didn't have access to a mirror. I'm curious for you guys, if you noticed that change your perception of yourself, or like when we were in towns, like staying in a hostel or something, and you did get a glimpse in the mirror, like if you noticed any different thoughts go through your head, what was that experience like of not like physically like really looking at yourself for such an extended period of time?
I love that experience. Yeah. I think I've had that experience before, and this sounds kind of cheesy, but this is what I think of when I'm out in the woods and I haven't looked in a mirror in a long time. I feel like I reflect the scenery that's around me. And so when I'm in the beautiful trees and by rivers and streams, I feel beautiful and I feel connected to it. And I did notice when we went into towns or hostels, if I would look in the mirror, I'd be like, oh God, and then I'd catch myself having that reaction. Like, no, I actually feel beautiful and I feel strong and I feel proud of myself and I feel joyful. Why does that have to change if I look in a mirror and see what I look like? So I definitely noticed that. And it was interesting to notice how I reacted when I did eventually look into a mirror.
Mm-hmm. That's so beautiful. I love that. I could just picture like you absorbing the scenery and like it like being like reflected back and like painted on you.
It is a very special time to not look at yourself every day, a few times a day, just be out there and like, it's almost like ignorance is bliss. Like you're just going about your day, not worrying about what you're wearing, what you're looking like, just what your hair is like, stripping away all those like artificial kind of things society imposes on you, especially as a woman, was really refreshing. When I looked at myself in the mirror, I think it was just like, cool. Like I feel good kind of thing, like feeling stronger every day. I think my confidence built over time, and that was reflected in how I viewed myself when I did look in a mirror.
Yeah I love that. Yeah, definitely my initial reaction looking in a mirror after not looking in a mirror for a while is like, ooh, like my eyebrows are kind of out of control, mm-hmm. and like, ooh, there's a chin hair that like sprouts every like 3 months that's like coming back, and like, wow, like, you know, oh, I didn't notice like, you know, a pimple might be coming there, there's like dirt there. But I have to agree really that like it's just such a cool thing that we were doing, and I feel like it just radiates and it just like I felt beautiful because I was like doing something that was so aligned with like my values and like my truth, and like being with my friends, being in nature, like doing something like that was taking me from like my phone and all those things. There's like, that's exactly like the kind of things I want to be doing. And I really do believe like people are most beautiful when they're doing things that are aligned with their soul.
Mm-hmm. Right. I would agree with that.
One other body image thing that I thought of a lot was body hair, because we weren't shaving out in the woods. And so I was kind of astonished at how much body hair I had, and looking at it at the beginning, I was like, oh God, that makes me uncomfortable. But I think it just makes me uncomfortable because societally we're told we're not supposed to have body hair as women. Mm-hmm. And so eventually I kind of stopped noticing it. It became less uncomfortable as it got longer. It was softer. Mm-hmm. And I found myself caring a lot more at the beginning. If people like saw how hairy my legs were, or my armpits, and I didn't really care as much at the end. And that was just another thing that I thought about a lot, that is just such a societal thing that is pushed on us as women. And I still felt beautiful with hairy arms and legs and hair everywhere.
Yeah. I think my thing was like smelling just like,
yeah,
hair.
Yeah.
It smells so bad. And we always talked about how we smell. It was just like something that comes with the territory, and you can either embrace it and be like, this is what it is, this is what's happening, or like suppress it. And that just, I feel like makes the experience more miserable. And somebody said, I forget who this was, just like embracing the suck. And looking at things that would typically suck in normal life and flipping that on its head and being like, this is dope. This is cool.
Yeah.
And just taking it all in for what it is and not trying to change it.
Yeah. I love this piece about like asking who, like, says who, like, oh, like body hair is bad. It's like, says who, like smelling bad is bad. Like, yes, says who, like just kind of like questioning, like, where did I learn this from? Cause these are all learned things. Like, you're not born thinking body hair is bad, smelling bad is bad. Mm-hmm. It's like something that gets ingrained in you along the way. And again, another like big parallel to body image, diet mindset of like, who said this food is like, you know, good and this food is bad. Like, who taught me that there's a right way for a body to look? I think looking at that is kind of like the first step to unlearning. Cause it's a real moment of realization of like, oh, this isn't actually me. Like, this isn't something that I was born thinking. This is something that I picked up along the way. Therefore I can choose to release it too. I can, if I learned it, I can unlearn it.
Yeah.
Yeah. I feel so grateful for this experience of going into the woods, because there wasn't a lot of that out there. It's kind of just, you're doing what you're doing, and you're not being consistently bombarded by social media or billboards or commercials or all of that stuff. It's a safe place.
Yeah.
Yeah. Until you walk by a group of people who took a shower and you're like, oh, yes. Smells
great. Oh my gosh. If you're listening.
So funny.
Oh my gosh. You all smell good.
You guys all smell great.
Someone from this community messaged me that we actually like ran into each other in the woods, but didn't say hi. It was like an after the fact realization for her, I think. And we were reflecting on that moment. And like, I remember the group, and if you're listening, I remember saying, like, oh my gosh, you smell like these girls smell so good. Like, cause the day hikers just like smelt better because they were coming from home and we'd been out there for a while. So if you're listening and heard me say, you smell so good, like, like a wild animal,
like a feral creature.
Like feral creature. Yeah, I was going to say, I'm sorry, but I'm not sorry. Like, I just know that that was coming from a place of love. Yeah, you have great shampoo. So a thought that I had that I haven't shared with you guys, the day we got back and we were kind of just like walking around, Victoria lives in Portland, Maine, and we were kind of like hitting the shops, I had a moment of feeling like pretty overwhelmed by like the idea of like dressing myself. And because we really were wearing like the same, like two, you know, we each had like two pairs of clothes pretty much for, you know, a few weeks that we were just in those clothes. So that was something I noticed of just like, ugh, like it just feels like so much to think about like dressing myself and like expressing myself in that way. But the thought I come back to that just like helps is like what Trix was saying of like, beauty and like style can be like within you, like the way that you like radiate and the energy you bring to a space. And like, yeah, it's nice to like wear an outfit that makes you feel good. But in those moments when getting overwhelmed of like, what do I pick? What do I put on? It's just like, for me, it really helps to just kind of release a little and know that like what you wear matters, but like who you are matters so much more.
Mm-hmm. Totally. It's definitely a balance. It's like indulging in dressing yourself is so fun. But when it comes to a point of like, being stressful and overwhelming, it's like, okay, this isn't fun. Let me take a step back and like not do this right now.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
That was actually a really interesting experience for me going to the, hitting the shops after our hike, because I bought three things that I normally would never wear, but I loved them in the moment. Yeah. And I really attribute that not to how it looked, but how it felt, and I felt really excited about these things.
Yes.
It felt like I was expressing from like my deeper self that I had connected with on the trail, rather than like, oh, this is in style or this is what I think looks good. I bought three things that I would never usually do, that I would never usually wear or buy, and I'm really excited about them. So trying to carry that with me of feeling very connected to myself and acting from that place instead of what I think other people think I should do.
Right. Intuitive dressing.
Intuitive dressing. Intuitive everything.
We love it.
So I have a few kind of like rapid fire questions for you guys, and whoever wants to jump in can go first. What was your favorite trail meal / food combo?
I loved the instant meals. Honestly, like thinking back, one of my favorite meals was being in the tent in a rainstorm, and we like used hot water from one of the huts and filled up our instant meal pouches and like scurried back to our tent in the rain. We just like ate them on the floor of our tent, and that was really special.
Chicken dumplings and pasta primavera.
Yeah, it's like
so good.
Bite bite pass, super good.
Nice.
Yeah,
I really liked. We had sweaty salami, sweaty salami, olives, relish, and mustard was all so good together. Like very intense flavors mm-hmm. were so good.
In the tortilla.
How could I forget?
Nice. No one's asking, but I'll tell you my favorite combo. I loved Fig Newtons wrapped in bacon. Like I was like, this is gourmet. This is like a bacon wrapped fig. It's like sweet and savory, which I love so much. And it's like carb and fat and protein. It was like, it was everything. It was so good.
You had a little charcuterie bite.
Yeah, it was a charcuterie bite. Exactly. What was something you were craving when you got off the trail?
Iced coffee.
Nice.
I think just like warm meals, something that was prepared by someone else.
Yeah.
And fresh stuff, a fruit. Yeah. Oh my God. I was dreaming of watermelon the whole trail.
Yeah.
Fruit.
Yeah. Yeah, I was really wanting vegetables mm-hmm. with we made Israeli salad with like feta and tahini and like that was like savory, good. Like savory fresh was mm-hmm. what I was craving. Okay, some non-food related rapid fire questions. What does intuition mean to you and how do you experience it?
Go ahead. I was just saying, I like that question.
That's, by the way, a question I've asked every guest.
It's a great question. I guess I could kind of try to explain what this means in my head. I said this earlier, but just what is satisfying in terms of what feels good for my body and also like what experience do I want right now? Because experience goes so well with what's satisfying. And I noticed a lot of the time on the trail, things tasted better or were so much better when we were like sitting by a river or just in a beautiful place and like really enjoying the space and the moment and the environment has so much to do with our intuition and like what feels good. Mm-hmm. So if I can like have a blend of all of those things, like environment and what's satisfying, really helps me decide what intuitively works.
Yeah. Yeah, that's such a you answer because like place and vibe and like vibe, aesthetics yeah. like aesthetics. Affects you. I think it affects everyone, but it's something we talk about a lot.
Yeah,
and you talk about a lot. What about the part of the question that is how do you experience it? Like, how does your intuition communicate with you?
Just what sounds good in the moment. What do I need in this moment, and what can I do to get there?
Yeah.
If I have the means to do it, do I have access to do these things? Can I make it?
Yeah. So like to arrive at what sounds good and where, like what, where in your body do you like hear that the answer of like, this sounds good?
It depends if we're talking about food or not, but I don't really have like a great secret answer to that.
It's a hard question.
Yeah. It's really hard, but when something pops into my brain and I'm like, yeah, that works. Like that's what I'm going with.
I think that's an important piece of like, it pops in and then it's like, it doesn't just pop in. It pops in and there's like a click of like, yeah, that's it.
Yeah. It's like what sounds good right now. Ooh, that's what I'm going to go with. Like this morning, for instance, like I've been craving some sort of like scone and I woke up this morning. I'm like, I'm going to a bakery and like getting a scone because that's what sounds good this morning. And that's what I'm going to do. That's kind of what that's
I know. It's a really hard question. That's a good answer.
It's really hard. Yeah.
Yeah. Trix, what about you? What does intuition mean to you and how do you experience it?
Intuition to me means honoring what I want and kind of separating what I want from what I think I should be wanting, which is something I do struggle with because I definitely have people pleasing tendencies and doing something that I think I should be doing versus doing something that I actually really want to be doing and that my body's telling me to do are two really, really different things. And sometimes I have a hard time distinguishing that, but I think that's what it means to me is really honoring what I want and being radically honest with myself of what I do want and what I do need in this moment. Mm-hmm. And how it manifests is I definitely feel something in my stomach, like right below my ribs and right above my belly button. There's like a ball right there. And that's usually when it's not good, when I feel that of like, I don't really like what I'm doing right now, or I don't feel like I should be doing this right now. But it's also kind of confusing to differentiate anxiety with intuition also. Yeah. Because as I was thinking about how it physically manifests, I was thinking about my hands too. I do a lot of fidgeting with my hands, but maybe that's just being a little bit anxious at the moment. But let's see, I'm trying to think of how it manifests when I'm like feeling positively about it. I think I just feel really comfortable in my body. If I'm doing something that I really love and feels really aligned with my intuition and what I want to be doing, I'm not thinking about my body as much as I am when it feels uncomfortable.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's like if you almost like no news is good news, like you're not getting any feedback. That's like, oh, but like if you are, it's like trying to tell you something's
right.
off.
Right.
Awesome. I love that answer. That's
a good question.
Is there anything else on either of your hearts that you're wanting to share, feeling called to share?
I feel so grateful to be on this podcast.
Such a dream come true.
An honor. Really awesome. Because seeing all of this come to life and seeing all of the different forms that it's taken, and now you have a podcast and all of your different ideas, it's been such a joy to hear that and be a part of it.
You guys are embarrassing me.
No, it's true. It feels really special because I feel like I'm tearing up. I feel like I heard about this and heard about this idea for so long, and here we are.
Being along on the ride with you has been so special, and like literally a journey of you getting here and then also taking this journey, like on this trip out of our comfort zone and just like pushing it a step further and being able to tie it into your passion and talk about our experiences, like we said, so impossibly special.
Impossibly special. It really is impossibly special, and I feel like it's such a dream for me to get to bring you guys into this space, because like we said in the beginning of this episode, like, thank God, like you guys both have beautiful relationships with food and your body. And it's funny, like Victoria, I remember when I first started like more seriously sharing content, like talking to you, and you're like, oh my God, like people are like actually like struggling with this. And I'm like, it's so amazing that you don't know. It's so amazing that you don't know. Yeah. And so you both have really been just like North Stars for me with my relationship with food, because, and I think about my friends from high school, and like a lot of them had fine relationships with food, but I think because I just like grew up alongside of them, it was different. Whereas like coming to college freshman year, seeing you both, there's so many examples I can think of, like going to the dining hall B, I remember you just like getting like, you'd be like, ooh, like there's fried rice today. And I'm like, oh my God, like she's genuinely excited to get what she wants. And Victoria, I remember sitting outside on the Davis Center lawn, and you're like telling me that your mom calls like a snack in the afternoon, an afternoon pick me up. And we got like iced coffees and like a giant cookie from Henderson's. And I was like, whoa, like you can do this? Like, it's crazy.
Yeah, it's been a really cool experience.
Being
out there.
It's so special, and I'm excited for the people to get to hear from you both, because you guys are so special to me. So thank you for being here. Is there anything you want to plug anywhere you want to?
No, my Instagram is like not important at all. So.
Your Instagram is not a what?
It's just not important. Like my 90 important. Pictures.
My 90 pictures aren't important. Well, these are my two of my BFFs. And if you want to know anything else about them or connect with them, you can come through me.
I'd be happy to talk to anyone.
I'm not good at social media at all, so.
And send their contact info, and you guys can chat. Thank you guys.
Thank you.
Love thank you, you Leah, so much.
If you enjoyed this episode, if it inspired you, if you learned something, it would mean so much to me if you rated it and reviewed it. And if you feel called to, share it with someone who it might resonate with. You can find me on Instagram at leahkern.rd. You can also join my weekly newsletter by visiting leahkernrd.com. And I'll see you next week.